Can you hear me now? Can you hear me yet? Can you hear me now? Can you hear me back there? Okay. It's amazing what happens when the microphone's turned on. It works so much better. And, first service, I have to say, the Lord just took over the service, and we didn't get to really get to the main sermon. We got to get to the tail of the sermon. But that's okay. We had an amazing time in the presence of the Lord, and it was actually a quarter after when I got to step up to the plate, if you will, and I was just asking the Lord as I was holding on to the pulpit to see whether I was going to just fall down or just keep going, whichever, and anyways, so we got to skirt around the sermon and get to actually something that's been dear to my heart as well. Anyways, so we're in week four of this series, Being the Church as a Family on a Mission. And I felt like, what the Lord first put on my heart was to do Romans chapter 6, which is the Declaration of Independence from Sin. For the Christians, just as the Declaration of Independence is for the person of the United States, a citizen of the U.S. But the church is a family on a mission, and that mission is dictated by the Word of God. That mission is led and guided and directed by the Word of God. And I was just reminded, Becky told me I didn't tell anybody why I had sunglasses on earlier. I think I sunburnt my eyes. So it's just more comfortable. So if you're not used to me up here with mild sunglasses on, no offense, get over it. Let's see, what do they say? Cry a river, build a bridge, get over it. No, anyways. It might be a little awkward for you. You think it's weird for you. You're all a much different color than I'm used to seeing you. Everything's orange-ish. The one cool thing, though, is if you're wearing green, it's green. You know, you look out on a lawn and you're just like, wow, that's awesome. You take your glasses off and go, it's not that awesome. Anyway, so the church is a family on a mission. And the mission of the church is real simple. And we can break it down to a million different parts and we can talk about it in a thousand different ways. And it's not necessarily right or wrong. But here's what we know. The church has a mission. The mission of the church is to breathe life into the community, to breathe life into one another, breathe life into the community, and are we supposed to breathe our life into the community or God's? Right. And that's so important because there's a lot of people who say, well, there is a certain way that we must do things in a certain way, in a certain time, in a certain manner, and have our hair up in a certain way, and wear our skirts just the right length and the right color blue jeans and or slacks only and on and on. In fact, you know why I'm wearing slacks today? Because these are expensive slacks that I bought back in my business days, and they're like wearing a pair of shorts in public. And I said to myself this morning, I'm not putting jeans on, although I like jeans. I'm not putting them on because they're like wearing sweaters. So I put these on. So once again, if you're into jeans and I'm into jeans, actually this time of year, I'd rather wear shorts all the time. But it would freak you guys out and you would be wearing sunglasses. So the church's mission is to breathe God's breath into the community. The church is also supposed to be unique. The church is not to be identical to the community. We have some similarities with the community, but we are aliens in this world, and as such, are the words that we use. Now be careful of Christianese. You know, when you walk out to somebody and you go, you know, Jesus is my propitiation. And they're like, do you have to go to the doctor for that? Which, yes, it just means covering over. And I saw that in Cambodia. The first time I ever saw rice put out on these mats. And I understood why when that woman in Jericho covered, or was it Jericho, wherever it was, somewhere. This is Caleb's day or something. Anyways, when they covered the guys that went down in the well with a covering and put grain on it, when I was in Cambodia, it was the first time I ever saw it happen in real life, and I went, oh, that's normal. I always thought, well, that's a weird thing to do. Anyways, the church is to be unique. The way we talk, the way we walk, the way we act, the way we react, the way we deal with people, the way that we don't let people deal with us. Anyways, and then it is to be a driving force. The church is not supposed to be, well, society, what do you think is right? We'll do that. Like it or not, that's disgusting. If you are a friend to the world, you are an enemy of God. And what it means is this, is that if you look to the world to get the how-to of life and how-to of how to do things and act and react and business and the way to do business and stuff, if you get that from the world, you are not listening to God. I can tell you this. I've been through business college. I've been through a lot of different things. And one thing I know is this, my time in the Word of God was the best training for business college. I understood things they were teaching me years after God already taught me. It was cool. You know what was also fun was with Fred Meyer Corp, we had more than one course that we took at the business college at main office. We had more than one course that came up that as I'm sitting in the course, I'm going, well, that's in the Word of God. 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 And I find out later on, Bob Moab, the guy does trainings for Christians. And the only difference that he does for business is he takes out the, and John 3:16 says, he takes out those verbiages, but it's biblical training. And guess what? It's life-giving. No matter whether you know who it is or not. Anyways, the church should be a driving force. We are not to stand aside. In fact, the scripture says that it is inappropriate for the man of God to step aside and let the enemy of people's souls have its way. In other words, we're supposed to stand firm, look them in the eye, poke them in the eye, and say, get out of here, right? So we're supposed to be a driving force, not a bunch of spineless. And actually, you know, I would say jellyfish, except for, do you know why people don't go up and play with a jellyfish? Because it looks cuddly until you touch it. Hey, let's look cuddly until they touch it. No. And the church is to be God-built. We keep talking about that week by week, but it's so important. When the Lord told us that we were coming here, I said, okay, God, what do you want us to do? And the first thing he said to me was, you are to build everything from the Word up. Not come up with some ideas or do some stuff and then find out if it lines with the Word. No, you're going to line up with the Word, and then you're going to filter everything through the Word and find out if it's still there. And if it ain't there, don't eat it. Don't touch it. Don't sniff it. Don't scratch it. Don't play with it. If it does not line up with the Word of God. Now, one of the things we know, like with the blessing of the bikes, for instance, I don't think you see a blessing of the bikes per se in the Word of God, except for you do see a Matthew and a Levi party, same guy actually, but you do see a Matthew party when he comes to Christ as a tax gatherer. What does he do? He has a party to get a bunch of people together to find and hang out with Jesus, right? That's all we're doing with like the outreach that's coming this Saturday. Is what we're doing is we're having a party where we're giving away a bunch of food like the 5,000 and the 4,000 Jesus fed, which was way beyond that. Anyways, that was just the men for some weird reason. Anyways, But we're inviting people to come get free food and free school supplies. You know what's cool about it is? That was on our heart to do. It was insurmountable for us financially. I mean, you know, in the simplicity of our brains. And God says, I want you to do it anyways. Becky kept getting pushback on back to school bash stuff. And it just wasn't working out to get, you know, the food outreach thing. And the next thing we know, within a 24-hour period, we've got a $70,000 truck, well, a $70,000 worth of food to give away that didn't cost us anything yet, because it is my endeavor now that we get to pay forward. Amen? And then also on the back-to-school bash part of it, we were handed Operation something, Homefront. It's a good thing somebody remembers what's true. Anyways, and then Becky went shopping yesterday, Becky and Ben, and went shopping yesterday, and so we have, a lot of backpacks and a lot of supplies, and do you know what? We don't have a clue what's going to happen for school this year, do we? But there's going to be some need. There's going to be need even in the homes. Anyways, the church should be built by God. And the thing is strategic. That's what we're doing. These things are strategies of God. He's saying, invite people in. Let me love on them. And I'll just say this. Even our garage sale was just a cool outreach this year. And I'm just so grateful to the Lord that we got to meet so many amazing people and just get to pray with people. And anyways, it was so good. So let's dig in. You got a couple minutes left, so let's dig in. So we've been going through Romans chapter 6, which verse 1 is, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin, that grace may increase? May it never be. How shall we who died to sin still live in it? And it goes on, and now we get to verse 15. What then? Shall we sin because we're not under law but under grace? May it never be. The may it never be literally means in the Greek, may it never be built. May it never be shored up. May it never be packed in. May it never be stuffed and put in the backpack. May it never be. In other words, we don't sin to make grace look cooler, because that would be goofy. And it's actually what Satan tells people. You know, if you sin, God's going to have to forgive you, and it's just going to make his grace look all the better. Kind of a dumb statement, really. Now, God does forgive big things, does he not? Yes, I think as long as you have breath, you can't do something that is unforgivable. The only thing we know is if you attribute the work of God to the devil and you knowingly know God did it, that's an unforgivable sin, because that is attacking the character of God. And we could talk about that all day long, and there's a lot more to say. But here's the deal. What then? Shall we sin because you're not under law but under grace? May it never be. And it goes on to say this, do you not know that when you present yourselves to someone as slaves for obedience, you are slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin resulting in death or of obedience resulting in righteousness? But thanks be to God that though you were slaves of sin, you became obedient from the heart. Notice it's from the heart. This is part of our vision and our mission statement as a church, is we become obedient from the heart, not obedient because, well, if I'm obedient, then I might stack enough rocks of doing good to get to God. And God says, no, I don't let anybody do that. In fact, when they tried to do that with the Tower at Babel, the Tower of Babel, when they were literally, it says, they were trying to get to God by building this tower that would reach God, and they would get there in their own way. And he goes, nah. And he changed all their languages in the twinkling of an eye. And you know what? I just think God's got a sense of humor. He created you and I, so I know he does. And here's the deal. I don't think he said, okay, level one, socks and shoes. No. I don't think he said, level one, you're all going to talk this way. Level two, you're all going to talk this way, and so on. I think he peppered it And they're all like, you know, and they all just kind of trickled down and couldn't get any work done. Otherwise, I think they would have kept working. But that's just me, because I'm honoring like that. I would do it to you. Became obedient from the heart, that form of teaching to which you were committed. And having been freed from sin, you became slaves of righteousness. Now, there's a difference between somebody who is tortured into slavery. There were people who would choose to become a slave, a servant of someone, to get paid by them more than they could make off their own land so they could buy the family a new Mercedes Camel. Right? Or a Ford donkey. Don't use the old word. Anyways. And having been freed from sin, you became slave of righteousness. That slave of righteousness becomes a bond slave. And it's kind of like what Jesus did. And when he allowed them to pin him to the cross, it's like when they would take their ear to the door. That felt good. They'd take their ear and they would poke it. They'd put a ring in it. And what that meant was, I choose, out of love for my master and my family, sometimes they had a family, and I choose to become a life bond slave, a love slave, a slave because of my love and appreciation to my master. That's what this is talking about. Bond slaves to righteousness. We better hurry up. You're going to run out of time. But thanks be to God that though you were slaves of sin, you became obedient from the heart, that form of teaching to which you were committed. And having been freed from sin, you became slaves of righteousness to follow God's way. You remember in the armor of God, you have this buckle of truth. You have this belt of truth. When you're belted around with the truth of God and the truth of his love and the truth of his way of looking at you and dealing with you, you notice what happens is you're freed. It's the belt of truth or the belt of freedom, and you are set free to thrive for God. Isn't that cool? So you can follow God's way. Let's go a little deeper. We got just enough time, I think. The scribes and the Pharisees brought a woman caught in adultery, and having set her in the center of the court, they said to Jesus, "Teacher, this woman has been caught in adultery, the very act." Before we go any farther, who's missing? The guy. She's been caught in the very act. How do you do that? You set it up. Why did they set her up? So they could set Jesus up. There's a lot more to this that we need to look at and know how Satan works. Satan sets us up. When something like this happens, this isn't happenstance. They didn't just happen by the house and you know. No. She was set up. The guy might even be part of the crowd. Wouldn't that be interesting if Jesus wrote in the sand, "You're the guy"? Don't you wonder what he wrote in the? And oh, I thought of this the other day as I was meditating on this, and I was doing a bunch of stuff, and then I just took some time to just relax and meditate on the word, and I was meditating on what the Lord wanted to talk about this Sunday. Anyways, and I thought about something. When Jesus wrote in the dirt, who made the dirt? You know what? We use iPads, iPhones, I this and I that, and tablet this and tablet that, and we make scratch and sniff things, and you know, and if you're really good, you could even write on one of those doohickeys that's got the two knobs with the magnet inside. Etch-a-sketch? Thank you. Here's Jesus, and I love it. I love it. It says, been caught in adultery. I'm getting ahead of myself. So they were saying this, testing him, so that they might have grounds for accusing him. Jesus stooped down with his finger and wrote on the ground. Again, when he stoops down, And all he uses is his finger, and he's writing on the ground. But remember this, the ground has to yield to his power. Never thought of it before. I wonder if his etchings might have been a little impressive. I wonder if they looked a little bit like the Ten Commandments in their original script. Kind of makes you wonder. And I'll bet you it's in Hebrew. And I'll bet it's in the ancient dialect, which is, oh, so cool. Looks like cuneiform, but better. And he's writing on the ground. And I wonder what he wrote. Like coveting, lust, wages withheld, adultery. That is my handwriting, so that's why it's hard to read. Pride, fornication. But notice what they did. They persisted in asking him. He already tells them they ought not to be doing what they're doing because none of them are without sin. But they persist. And he straightens himself up. Now, I look at it this way. When he stooped down, he did not come below them. He didn't come below them in any way authority-wise, because you know why? The Lord can never become under you in authority. But what does the devil try to get you to do? To believe Jesus is not the I am in the flesh. Because if you believe that he's not the I am, if you believe that he's less than who he is, if you believe that lie, then you'll start to think that Jesus shouldn't be your master, your savior, your everything, the one in whom you quiet your soul before, or the one that can protect you from the enemy. That's why the enemy's trying to get you to believe something about Jesus that's simply not true. When Jesus, wherever Jesus is, however Jesus is, however God is, it's not changeable. And it's inappropriate to try to get him to change. Number one, he won't. Number two, he can't be. He's called immutable. He's unchangeable. You can't restructure him, but people do. That's a different sermon. But when they persisted in asking him, I think about this. When he knelt down in authority and wrote what would make the sailor blush. I'll bet you. I don't know. But when he stood up, oh, he stood up as Jehovah Nissi. He stood up as El Elyon in Elohim. He stood up as El Shaddai. He didn't just stand up. He didn't just get up. He came up. And oh man, can you just see his power? It's like in the garden when he said, who are you looking for? Jesus the Nazarene. And he goes, I am. And they all go poof. Not one person was able to stand. And they still attacked him. Oh, I wish we were smarter. I'm talking about me, not you. That sounded bad. But when they persisted in asking him, good grief, after he wrote stuff on the ground, he straightens up and says to them, he who is without sin among you, let him be the first to throw a stone at her. Hear his love. Again, he stooped down and wrote on the ground. He didn't stoop down to their level. He, in authority, he bared himself, saying, I'll take the hit. I'll take the hit. But at no point in time was he backing off in authority. And boy, if they would have hit him, I think they would have had a bad day. And when they heard it, they began to go out one by one, beginning with the older ones, and he was left alone, and the woman, where she was in the court, center of the court. I just want to say this too. One of my favorite parts of this entire passage isn't just that the woman gets forgiven by the Lord and he blesses her life if she will walk for him and with him. But I love this, is that the older ones set the precedence of what needed to happen. Yes, they were caught with their scripture down. They were caught unknowing the scripture. They were caught at they were caught to the point of embarrassment. They were caught to the point of fighting words. And I love it that the elders were the first to repent and walk away, because the scripture says that the older men should teach the younger men, and the older women should teach the younger women. And in a lot of different aspects, it doesn't mean that you can't be younger and be a teacher. I've gotten to do that anyway, some things like this since I was 17, but I always understood that the Lord prefers to have those that have walked with him for a long period of time to be the trainers. Anyways, I love that part. But and he was left alone, and the woman, she was in the center of the court. And again, he stoops down, maybe gluttony, lust of the eyes, ego, pride of life, lust of the flesh, because that's all Satan really uses. And straightening up again, he says to her, "Woman, where are they? Did no one condemn you?" Now remember, he's standing in his authority. She says, "No one, Lord." Jesus said, "Neither do I," or "I do not condemn you either." And the "go" there is the same "go" as in Matthew 28, 19 through 20. Go. "And he whom the Lord sends is sent with the Spirit without measure." Amen? And in fact, they preach the word of God, and they're sent with the Spirit without measure because God has sent them. Anyways, "go from now on and sin no more." It was a powerful "go." It wasn't a, "Hey, here's a good idea." She was forgiven to thrive. And we'll see her again another day. Here's what's important. Do not judge according to appearance, but judge with righteous judgment. There is a lot of people out there trying to get Christians and conservatives, if you will, but they're trying to get Christians to judge according to what the pressure from society is trying to get them to do things society's way because of pressure of a few loudmouth, unwise people. Actually, you know, one of the descriptions in Scripture of a wayward woman and a wayward man is they're extremely loud. I was in a place yesterday, and I heard somebody who was using foolish words, and they were the loudest person on location by far. And I'm like, wow, the Scripture's correct. Check one off for Jesus. Got it right. I mean, good night. I think the restaurant next door heard him, and they're across the street. I was like, illa. We need to judge with righteous judgment. The problem is the enemy's trying to get us to judge things based on what we see. If Jesus would have judged this woman based on what they said, based on the allegations, based on what they said was going on, and apparently she did something, but I still think she was set up. It still comes down to he judged her based on what he knew needed to be done. It is not his desire. He did not come to ruin people's lives, but that they would have life and have it to the full, to save people's lives. So he judged what was going on based on his heart. Remember, his heart is not changeable. It's predicated on love. The whole cornerstone comes out of, "I love you, so I knit you together in the womb for good works that you should live them out. I will give you my word because it'll equip you for every good work. Now get out there," Revelation 3. "Now get out there with zeal and do what I've asked you to do, and I'm going to help you all along the way." You see, his love doesn't change, ever. It's all based on his love. He will deal with the sons of disobedience. He will deal with all that. But it's always from the point of love. What then? Shall we sin because we're not under law but under grace? Obviously, may it never be. May it never happen. We need to have an attitude of gratitude. You know, there's a scripture, and I think it's in the Proverbs. But a man with a grateful heart has a continual feast. You know what? Lately, God has been giving me a continual feast. He has been setting a table for me in the midst of my enemies. And you know what I love about that, though? Is the more you feast at his table and you recognize him for who he is, the more you also recognize who the enemy has said are your enemies who are not your enemies. They may have done something dumb, but they're not your enemies. We get reminded as we are hanging out with God and we're supping with God and we're, and I could use a little coffee, so I'm going to sup with him. Is the more you sup with God, the more you start seeing who the real enemy is, and you can actually pray for those who have wrongly accused or wrongly attacked or whatever, and you start praying for them and truly, 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 truly want to see them thrive with God, and what happens is the enemy loses his strength, his power, and his manipulation ability. And you start thriving even more, and so do they, actually. Let's read this John 3:16 together. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send the Son into the world to judge the world, but that the world might be saved through him. I don't know how many versions of this I have in my head, so my brain is trying to change words as I go. But years ago, in my studies and digging things out in the Greek and stuff, I learned something about the word shall and should. Today's modern shall not perish is the old use of what we now call a should. You see, the devils know who God is. The devils believe who he is. The devils believe in who Jesus is because they get the tar kicked out of him all the time. But those of us who know who the Lord is and believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. But you see, we can know who, believe in who he is. And of course, the believe means that you're willing to come under his authority, but in our English, sometimes we make it muddy. The point is, the should is just more accurate. They should not perish, but have eternal life. And remembering that God did not come into the world to destroy the world or to kill, steal, and destroy, but he came into the world that we'd have life and have it to the full. Amen? Oh man, you're out of time. Not really. So this is why we exist. This is why we exist. This is why the body of Christ exists. Did you know that you were not saved so that you could sit somewhere and sing, I shall not be moved. I shall not be moved. Don't you dare tell me to do anything I don't want to. I'll follow you everywhere I want to go. But if you dare tell me where to go, well, I'll be moved. I'll move away. And you're going to miss out on what I give. You know, the bad part is, what they don't realize is, the Lord they walked away from is crying, not because they intimidated him, but because he misses them already. He misses getting his arms around their heart. He misses getting to direct their lives and help them to become the people he made them to be. He misses, and he hates what's going to happen to them based on the results of if they start investing into the love bank of Satan. Satan is going to reward them based on Satan's heart, which is kill, steal, and destroy, right? So we exist to be the church as a family on a what would Jesus do mission. I think we need to get a bunch of those what would Jesus do things again. You know, those are just the modern day tassel. That's all they are. It's a reminder of what should I be doing. And you know what? It's not a bad idea to have something in your pocket, whether it's a penny or a dime in your shoe. I used to do that to remind me to pray for my pastor, or certain things. I would put different size coins in one of my shoes. And every time that coin drove me nuts, it would remind me, don't forget to pray for this. Anyways, the church is a family on a mission, a what would Jesus do mission. Here's how we see it. Is we're favored by God, not that nobody else is favored, but all of God's kids are favored. Amen? You can't come to Christ unless you is. Anyways, but this is what God put on my heart. We are Lapine Christian Family Worship and Training Center. We are a family to find, thrive in, and learn to share God's divine favor and intentionally live a favored life. A lot of people don't know how to do that, so we do our Ministry Training Institute, our college, and things that we do, our Bible studies are based on the Word. Anyways, we are a family called to help all God's creation. And that's, again, why we do outreach, because we're out there to reach God's creation, all of God's children. Remember this, everybody we talk to and that you talk to are part of the family of God. The difference is, if they have not graduated into the Lamb's Book of Life, they won't make heaven. But everybody qualifies for the family album because they were all created by Him to be His kid. But not everybody will choose it. Anyways, we're a family called to help all God's creation to find Jesus, accept Jesus, verify His claims, lovingly obey His words and leadings, reveal Him to others, to emerge, which means to come out and live the favored life with others, and then to be a disciple who teaches others how to intentionally live a favored life. Seems simplistic. There's a lot more levels, but that is. And it comes down to this. Love is the motivation. And I put on there, pray until something happens. Push. And the reason why is because the enemy has got a lot of people wondering, where is God? The enemy has convinced a lot of people that God doesn't exist, or that He's not big enough to help them, or that He doesn't care, and on and on and on and on. But you see, God never moved. And again, it'd probably be better to use the cross or that particular banner. But the deal is, God has never moved. But Satan says, oh, He's over there. Oh, He's over there. Oh, He's over there. Oh, he's wherever your attitude wants Him to be. Thanks be to God that He is not right where I want Him to be. Because at one moment, I want Him to be this way. And the next moment, I want Him to be this way. And what I know is this, if I were God, I would not be alive. Because I definitely would have zapped the man in the mirror years ago. Right? The reason God won't let you be deity and He won't let you be God is because you ain't. And you are not going to get omnipotence. You're not going to get omniscience. You're not going to get omnipresence. You're not going to get it all. You're going to get whatever He needs you to have or wants you to have, or you avail yourself to have. Amen? And again, the reason He won't let you be deity, He won't let you be God, because one, He can't. He probably could, I guess. But He won't, because He knows it's not best for us. And there's not a one of us that'd be alive today. Because when we made those dumb, unwise things, decisions, we would have went, oh, I'm so sick of me. Garrock. Oh, dang it, there's another pile of human. get out the magic bag, you know, the Dyson. Some need it anyways. Love is the motivation. Love is the whole reason that God gets his arms around us. And back to Jeremiah chapter 1. The first thing that comes to mind is not just the knit you in the womb, but God asked Jeremiah a question. What do you see? And Jeremiah tells him what he sees, the rod of the almond tree and so on. And God says this, you're right, I am watching over my word to ensure that it does exactly what I sent it to do. Do you know that God has spoken a word over your life? And he's watching over the word or words he's given you for your life, and he's ensuring it will happen just like he said. And by the way, when, not the if, when you do something dumb, number one, he doesn't go, oh, I just can't believe they did that. Because he knows the end from the beginning. The other is when he said, hey, follow me, I'll make you fishers of men. He knew what you would do ahead of time, and he knew how to work out your mistakes. Look to him, surrender to him, abide in him. Amen? So let's close with this. My soul, wait in silence for God only, for my hope is from him. He only is my rock and my salvation, my stronghold. I shall not be shaken. This is Psalms 62, 5 through 8. On God my salvation and my glory rest. The rock of my strength, my refuge is in God. You know that immutable one, unchangeable. Trust in him in all times, especially now, right? Trust in him, O peoples. Pour out your heart before him, because God is a refuge for us, Selah. And I want to encourage you, get a piece of paper, get something to write on. You can do this at home, you can do it here. Actually, I have some more of these left if you want to do one. It's a petition before Almighty God. Write down those things that your petitions are before God and set them out like Hezekiah did. Lay them out before God and fast and pray and ask God for help. And the first thing you'll find out is they're not harassing you as much as they're harassing God. And then you'll hear God say, if you'll quiet yourself before me, at the moment you fully surrender and say, God, I surrender to you how to do this. I need your help. I need you to be the overcomer. At the moment you bow, God's on full strength. And he goes, oh, this is my kid. You're messing with my kid. And you know what the devil does? Okay, I'm done. Because you know what? He's been whooped by God more than once. He was whooped by God at the cross. He was whooped by God in the sepulchre. He was whooped by God in heaven when he lied and got a third of the angels to follow him, trying to take God's throne. And God said, you know, just get out. And he's been whooped by God every time he whoops on you. Read Isaiah 54 and memorize Isaiah 54:17. And you will not regret it. You will not regret it. We'll close with that. Isaiah 54:17. No weapon that is formed against you shall prosper. Every tongue that accuses you in judgment you will condemn. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their vindication is from me, declares the Lord. You can take that to the bank. It is a promissory note that has more validity than anything man has ever printed with a micro reader and little non-reproducible stuff. When God tells you that you have a heritage, that you have an inheritance, that you have His protection, that He is your vindicator, your mentor, and your intercessor, when He says that, He is not kidding and He won't back down. You've got to take that to the bank, because the enemy's trying to get you to believe it is written on fake paper. The enemy is the one who goes around as if a roaring lion, seeking who he may devour, and he roars because he's a toothless and he's a fake. God is not toothless, and God is not a fake. And when the enemy sticks his head up, yes! Let's stand together. Let me pray over you. I can't really see the clock very well, so I have no idea if we're on time, off time, under time, over time, get over it time. So I say that I pray this prayer only because the Lord said so. Because He said this, and it's in Numbers 6. 24, 25, 26. He said this, "Thus you shall bless the sons of Israel, and we are children of God. You shall say unto them, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up His countenance on you and give you peace. And so thus you shall invoke My name upon My kids." Lord, when you straightened up in defense of that woman who had been set up to set you up, when you straightened up in full authority, you didn't speak those people with the wrong attitudes to a pile of dust like they deserved. Because you didn't even come to destroy their lives, though they tried to destroy another life. Instead, in your mercy and grace, you taught them what was right, and you allowed them to respond in repentance. It's up to you how far that went. But Lord, when you looked on that young lady, or old lady, whatever she was, when you looked upon her, she didn't see the eyes of fire. She didn't see the eyes of, "I'm going to get you for that." She saw the eyes of compassion that said, "Where are your accusers?" And she said, "There's none." He said, "Neither do I. Go and sin no more." Lord, thank you that today you remind us. Just go and sin no more. And go show the world who I am. He is who you are. And God, at the end of the day, will fulfill your dream for our lives. Thank you, Lord of the harvest, for even sending us in and letting us be a part of your team. We don't deserve it more than anybody else. We just say thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, God bless you. Thanks for being here. Next week, bring your sunglasses. I might have my shorts on. I'm just kidding. Maybe a hula skirt.